Well, we are all interested about whether or not there is life outside Earth. We all are puzzled by it, isn't it? When we look up at the night sky, we think about the number of stars that are there, the number of planets that are there, and we keep thinking about whether or not there's somebody else like us. Well, a brilliant young mind from Bengaluru has got us one step closer to finding the answer to that. He joins us today on this News 9 special. Thank you very much, Madhu, for speaking to us, and congratulations on achieving special recognition from ESA, from the European Space Agency. You're the new young researcher. ESA is the equivalent of NASA in Europe.
Yeah,
and they've lauded you for the award you've received in your research in
exoplanetary systems.
Exoplanetary systems in finding out whether or not we have Earth-like planets outside. How do we exactly relate it to Earth? Can you tell us a little more about what exactly you've done?
Yeah, actually, we wanted to find a twin Earth. That's our motive behind the work. So we started working on Earth-like planets, looking at its size, density, surface temperature, escape velocity. And we had one more problem, that surface temperature cannot be easily be measured. We can't put a thermometer inside a planet and check.
That's millions of light years away.
It's millions of light years away. And we can't send a probe also. Yeah. So.
Fair enough.
What we did was we could calculate the whatever space telescopes that's present right now, Kepler and Carrot by French. So we got the data from these people, and we analyzed this data, and we found out a technique to find the surface temperature by just using our own solar system objects, which are rocky, like. Earth is a rocky planet, Mars is a rocky planet, but Jupiter is a gas giant. There is no, you can't stand on Jupiter.
Exactly.
So we took up only rocky planets and we calibrated a technique which would suit the surface temperature, and linear regression gave us an equation to find.
All right. For the common man, for the normal mind over here that's listening to this, what he's basically done is he's found out a new way in which we can find out the temperature of a planet, the surface temperature. Like, for example, we are on Earth, the temperature here, we're able to find out. A similar way he's found out a method of finding out surface temperature of other planets far, far away from here. And perhaps that gives us a little more insight into whether or not they could be life over there. Now, that's something very big. People don't understand the repercussions of your findings, you know. It looks like just an equation on paper.
Yeah.
And, you know, some people can say, oh, yeah, he's gone through so much research, he's come up with this equation.
Yeah.
But there are very, very huge ramifications of your paper, isn't it?
Yeah, actually, because temperature plays a very key role. Because if you are too close to the sun, then it's too hot. If it is too far away from the sun, it's too cold. For Earth-like planets, it's habitable.
Yeah, so, we're talking about the Goldilocks zone.
Yeah, Goldilocks zone where water can, you can have water. And Mars is at the edge of the habitable zone. So.
But it is in the habitable zone.
Yeah, it is in the habitable zone, but it's at the edge of the habitable zone. And there are many speculations that in ancient timeline, Mars could have had life before Earth.
So it is possible that at one point there was life on Mars.
Life on Mars, and something bad happened, and
now there is no atmosphere.
No, there is no atmosphere and magnetic
temperatures
field.
Temperatures are extreme.
Yeah.
You know, Madhu, this question, I think even a child, every time he looks up at the sky, he thinks, is there somebody else like me out there? You know, that's, it's very arrogant of humans to think that in this huge cosmos, we're talking about billions of galaxies, we're talking about billions and billions of solar systems, we are the only life.
Yeah.
how presumptuous is that?
Actually, we can't take it for granted because a sky is a vast thing, and we don't have enough funding to search the whole sky itself. So, to begin with, we are heading in the right direction, and we are making good progress. But it's not a fast progress, but it's a steady progress. So, once we get substantial funding and approval of all the governments and everything, maybe one day,
Yeah, but you know, once we get it, you see that happening?
Not right away, but it's gonna happen.
So. We're really not spending that much on scientific frontier, isn't it?
No,
need to spend a lot more.
Not just spending on, also you have to spend it wisely. Like, for example, NASA and ESA, most of the space agencies are funding. For space telescopes, even we have telescopes at ground based, which are very good, excellent telescopes, and even Kavalur Observatory, which is Asia's largest telescope. So we are doing progress,
but we don't have one in space.
Yeah, I think if somebody, you know,
if we have a Kepler launched by India, then
maybe we can call it.
But you understand that we could call it that, or we could call it The Namo telescope, considering the time.
Yeah, that would be excellent.
We need something in space.
Yeah, we need something in space to track things. But we have different kinds of things. Like for communication, we have MOM for with Mars and stuff. But for exoplanetary-based research, we are yet to focus on. I don't know. For my present understanding, I have not seen people funding in that area. So, if it is possible in the future, it would be wonderful.
It would be wonderful. Now, you went to Netherlands to gather your award, to collect it. And you met with a lot of other young minds, a lot of other old minds as well, the stalwarts of astrophysics. What do you think, the world of astronomy, it's so vast, but where do we stand in...
Okay. Actually, I asked the same question to the director of ESA, and his name is Professor Bernard Foing. He's a very famous person, and he is on our. He is totally into building moon village on moon.
Wow, a village on the moon.
Yeah, village on the moon. They want to colonize moon first, and also Mars. And they are not just making instrumentation; they are also bringing laws. Which country should own what?
Wow.
And stuff like that. And even if somebody passes away, for example, a loved one passes away, how do we send a message back?
My God.
Everything is discussed.
Oh God, that is, wow.
Yeah. And also they want to, energy is some most important criteria. So they are planning to ask this space architects. And I met few of them, and they are planning to print this solar, organic solar cells, which can be used as a paint. House.
My like God. And that's going to power the houses and the villages.
The so they want
wow.
us.
I had no idea.
They literally printed and brought to my hand. So wow. Yeah, it was a wonderful experience. And there are many great works are going on, not just in our country. Even our country is doing good progress. Mm-hmm. And most of the ESA collaborations are with ISRO as well. So mm-hmm. we are doing our part. And I think the whole world needs to stand up to answer this big question.
It does. It's a very big question. You know, people, as far as we can remember, even Greek philosophers used to keep wondering about this. Are we alone in the universe? Yeah. Are we alone? Is there life? Then there were, many theories that came about, like the Earth is the center of the universe. Yeah. Then we knew that, no, the Earth orbits around the Sun. Yeah. Then people thought the Sun is the center of the universe. Then we know that, no, it's just, a part of the galaxy. We are not even in the center of the galaxy.
Yeah.
So, myths keep on getting busted.
Yeah.
And we start learning more and more about the universe as we progress.
Yeah.
But, we understand less than about 4% of the entire universe.
Exactly.
Very less.
Yes.
We need to learn more and more.
Even
and
though it's a $1 billion investment.
Exactly.
We understand only 3%.
Yeah. And you know what surprises me is the fact that India has a lot of talent. India has a lot of brilliant minds like yourself. Many brilliant minds in the country. But perhaps, they either lack the motivation or the research materials or the technology. So, you being in Bangalore, what motivated you to go ahead and do this research, and how could you go about it? Because I'm pretty sure that you did not have the state-of-the-art equipment. You just had a guidance and a will. How did you go about it?
Actually, I have to say special thanks for receiving this award to my professors, Professor Goodenauer from Christ University and Dr. Margarita Safanova from Indian Institute of Astrophysics. So, she's a Russian, and we gelled very well, and we had lot of arguments, disagreements, and we started this work. Initially, when we started this work, I wanted to find Earth-like as well as Mars-like. She used to ask me all the time, "What do you want to find Mars-like planets?"
I was about to ask you the same thing. Why do you want to find Mars-like?
Mars-like planets, and because Curiosity rover, that's the answer. Curiosity rover dug up some methane-specific material which metabolizes from microbial forms. So there could have been life on Mars. So Mars is not a, getaway candidate.
So even a possibility of finding a Mars-like planet outside could indicate life. Yeah.
That's the reason. Wow. Yeah. That's the reason I wanted to concentrate on Mars. For some reason, whenever we look into it in depth, we don't get a particular answer to say there was no life in Mars, because we had traces of water. And we had
methane.
So we have so much information about the red planet, and we have only two rovers running around, maybe some more. But in the future, they are planning to, even digging millimeter is not an easy task on Mars.
Absolutely.
So first you have to land and then start digging up the samples. And And one key thing is, whatever you do, you have to bring the Indian here, because we need to have a Raman spectrometer, whatever happens. So whether to study, so usually everybody has Raman spectrometers to check what are the things that's available. So once we get the information from there accurately, then, you know.
You know, I want to get back to your paper at this point of time over here. Now, you have suggested that to find out whether or not there's life on other planets, there's an Earth similarity index. That index should depend, you suggest, on the surface temperature and other parameters.
Size.
That could perhaps give us a better understanding of whether or not there's life over there. Now, tell me one thing, isn't it a little presumptuous to think that we are trying to find life as we know it on other planets? There could be life otherwise.
I totally agree with that, because life does not mean a human being with two eyes, two nose.
Absolutely.
So there could be a possible, there could be 100 possible ways of us, a different species. So once, but only thing is, we are launching something very awesome, like JWST, James Webb Space Telescope, which will be launched very soon. It has something called as biosignature detector.
Okay.
So it's gonna detect the, you know, gases around, and if there is some form of life, we might get a hint.
This biosignature, it probably will be looking for hydrocarbons. What is to suggest suggest that only hydrocarbons can be the signature of life?
Because as we...
That's life as we know it.
Yeah, that's the reason.
But that could be anywhere. We, you could have silicon-based life. You could have any other...
And also, there are different weird kind of planets we know already.
Absolutely.
One of our Indian... Dr. Nikku Madhusudan, who is in Cambridge University right now, he is called the diamond scientist of India, because he found an exoplanet where diamond rinds. So there is no silica there. So there could be a diamond form of life, but we have not come across that. But as a scientist, I can't say it. Unless we have a evidence, solid evidence, as a science person, I can't say for true.
You know, there are very funny planets out there. The Kepler, especially, since it has been launched, about 3,635 planets, roughly.
3,500
planets that have been found out that could possibly have life like the way we know it on Earth. Possible.
Actually, most of the candidates are hot Jupiters. When we say hot Jupiters...
So hot Jupiters, how can it have life then?
So those candidates will be thrown away. So those planets will be thrown away for like... we are not looking into detail for life.
So we're looking for rocky planets.
Rocky planets, where then we follow the water. First we find the rock, then we follow the water. So
whether it can have surface
or not. Yeah, exactly. Rocky, and ours is a rocky water planet. So we have rock as well as water. So we want to search for such kind of planets. And
but there are so many planets that have been found that have two stars, two star systems, binary star systems, and there are very there are so many stars that are far less luminescent than our sun. In which case the planet needs to be closer to the sun for life to exist. There are so many permutations and combinations, and it's really odd, you know. I've been doing a little research on the Kepler myself. So many planets that have been detected haven't actually been sighted. They haven't been sighted. They've seen the movement of the stars, and they believe that the planet's gravity is exerting a force on the stars, and that's causing the movement. The planet hasn't been sighted. But still we're able to say that, yes, there is a planet. Yes, this could be the size of the planet. Yes, this could be the temperature. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah. Actually, in order to say it in brief, like it, basically we are looking at the eclipse of the planet with respect to our Earth.
Yes.
So we see, we plot brightness on one axis and time on the other axis. So the brightness will be constant. Once the planet is in front of the sun, there is a dip.
And that minor dip can be detected.
Using that dip, we are going to calculate the size.
And you all observe the periodicity of the dip as well. And then you all can say, okay, this rotates so many times around the planet. That is, you know, I cannot even begin to think how many minds have spent, how many mind-numbing hours, you know, trying to find this out. But in your research, Madhu, something very interesting popped up. You basically have, in essence, you have shelved completely the previous methods of finding life. You've come up with a new technique altogether.
Actually, this Mars-like planets was one of the key thing I was interested in. And so Earth-like planets, people were trying to find Earth-like planets, but I wanted to go in detail with Mars-like planets, as I was suggesting, for extremophile life forms. And presently, the EXPOSE mission from Russia, which is presently on International Space Station, they have come up with two microbes, two extremophiles, which could survive. And there was one, Acarospermato, which survived for 1.5 years. Wow. So that's a positive, you know, approach to, you know, search whether maybe we can have bio mining there, but it's gonna take a long time. Even NASA is planning to do this bio mining thing, so they wanna inject a lot of microbes into the planet, and so that they can start getting metals together. So it's a long process, but yeah, but it's not an impossible task. But it's gonna take a lot of funding, attention, and everything.
You know, thinking about the kind of difficulties that the young minds are facing, I'd rather have somebody like Madhu pursuing that challenge. I, for myself, find it a Herculean challenge. I don't know how it's even going to be a reality. But let's hope, fingers crossed, that that does happen. Now, at the moment, we're going to slip into a short break. But on the other side, we're going to have more interesting conversations with Madhu about life outside Earth. Stay tuned. Well, welcome back. So Madhu, you were in the Himalayas, I believe. What happened? You want to give everything up?
Actually, no, I was not in the Himalayas. I used the telescope in the Himalayas.
So you used a telescope in the Himalayas. What were you looking at? Tell me.
We were looking at two exoplanets. One is WASP-33b, and another one is Kepler-76.
Why do they grab your interest?
Because we wanted... Magnetic field is a key thing because I know those are hot Jupiters. We don't have a technique to detect the magnetic field of a planet. Exoplanet.
But from the telescope you can?
Yeah, we can. And also we wanted to look at the larger planets. First, I wanted to get a feel for how these things transits and stuff.
So when you actually look into these telescopes, all you see is one dot, right? What do you see?
Actually, to be honest, the telescope is in Himalayas. We observed it from Bangalore because the control is in the lab here in the Indian Institute of Astrophysics near Hoskote. So we, me and my supervisor, Dr. Firoza from IIA, so we wanted to know how these things transits. So we wanted to check on, these are huge planets, not, we were not.
They are huge, no doubt, but yeah. What you see in your lab is basically two dots.
To be honest, all we see is some starry background, and yeah, you know, we wait for something to happen.
And you and look at those fuzzy
we
images.
We write some numbers, and we get the spectrum of it, yeah.
So you look at these fuzzy images.
Yeah.
And then you try to find whether there is life on that or not. That's man.
Not just life. We
learn more about
More about it. We want to know their atmosphere, what happens there, and we also get the spectrums of it. So spectrums tells us a lot of things. What elements are there?
Yeah, I'm sure it does. But isn't it weird? You know, because all we can see from here, even you know, I was trying myself to grab a view of Saturn. Saturn or Jupiter, it just looks like one fuzzy blob just moving around.
Yeah.
It's very difficult because we look at science books and we see that Jupiter is this huge planet with a giant gash in the middle.
Yeah.
We see Saturn with beautiful rings around it. And then we look at the telescope and all you can see is two dots.
Because
the dots are
away.
Shifting.
Yeah.
And we're like, this is what people are talking about. This is disappointing. It's really disappointing, man.
No, actually, it's not so disappointing because it's actually fun for me the way I look at it. Because
looking at those fuzzy dots is fun for you.
Because those fuzzy dots tell you a lot of things. The light what I'm seeing is very ancient than me. I see it.
Yeah, you know, I want to get to that. Let me interrupt you on that.
Yeah.
This is something that I figured out by myself, okay? Yeah. I'm not a genius,
okay.
But this I could figure out by myself.
Yeah.
That in the night sky, when we look at the stars, the light that is coming and falling into our eyes, what we detect as light or stars, that light could have left a star billions of years ago. That star could have died.
Okay.
And the light is still coming. You're looking at billions of years into the past.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
That's
right?
Really amazing. That's what fascinates this field. And one more fascinating thing is whatever sunlight we are receiving every single day, it's not 8 minutes old.
It's not 8 minutes old.
In the core,
yeah,
there is
the
a thermonuclear.
Yeah, from the core to come out, it takes a lot of time. Yeah.
It's 1,096 years old.
Wow.
What happens is the core, thermonuclear fusion, hydrogen becomes helium, the photon random walks, hits
by
collision.
By the time that photon comes to the surface and comes out, it takes
more than 1,096 years.
So we are witnessing history as we speak.
Yeah. So whatever we are seeing into the past. We are always interested in how everything started.
Yeah.
We want to know. Because we live in a universe, we want to understand how. Because you have a neighbor, okay? You want to know about your neighbor.
Yes.
So similarly, we want to know where the place where we live, and we need to understand how everything works around here.
But then there are people who say, okay, this has been put in place by somebody. That's just the way it is. You're not going to question it.
See, human mind is the mind that questions everything. Yeah. It can't, you can't lock up a person and say think nothing. Mm. That's not going to happen. You have to think, and thinking or what makes us, you know, collaborate, work, happiness, joy, everything. Thinking brings lot of joy.
It does. You know, there was this very interesting piece I had read by a man called Gregory David Roberts. He had written a book called Shantaram, in which he narrates his encounters with the Mumbai Mafia. He was from Australia. In which he says that he met one of these mafia underlords who says that I don't believe in a god or a creator, but I believe that everything started from one point. That's the singularity that we refer to. From there, the Big Bang, we say. He says, I would like to refer to that singularity as God. But then there are scientists who say that that singularity has emerged from somewhere.
Somewhere.
What
yeah.
is the history of that singularity?
Yeah, that's a loopy question.
Those are very
it's
good
like,
questions.
Yeah, for example, you don't know whether the egg came first or the chicken first.
Came
it's
first.
A loop. So it's an infinite loop. We as human minds, we can understand a part by part. We can't understand the whole thing.
But when you talk about fact-based, evidence-based science, there's no other science. It has to be fact-based, evidence-based. You can deduce a few things, but that also has to be derived from a certain, you know, scientific train of thought.
Because we go through the literature.
You just can't say, okay, this is how it is, that's how it's going to be, no questions asked.
If you say that, people are going to laugh at you.
Exactly. But science allows you to do that. There is also a very opposite train of thought that, you know, makes a roadblock to the scientific progress. They say that, why are you questioning things that shouldn't be questioned? These are things that shouldn't be questioned. Why are you questioning about these things? It's a creation. That's how it is. That's how it's supposed to be. Don't question it. What do you say to them?
So, it's a metaphysical question rather than a physics question.
Yes, metaphysics is.
Okay. Yeah, it's not a joke. And some people take it very seriously. But according to my understanding, whatever I see, whatever physically I see, I want to understand that.
Hmm.
There are certain questions which bother us all the time. Mm. We don't know how everything's... We don't have answers for everything. That's
yes.
what makes life more joyful. If you had everything answered, then you had nothing to
no
do.
No purpose.
There was no work. There was no job. Nothing. You're jobless. You're just sitting.
But think about it. It does sound interesting, by the way. No job, no work.
So
it does sound interesting.
No, it's not actually. So because they actually tried to do this experiment, like how long a human being can remember time.
Mm.
Like they did it in MIT or somewhere, I read this, and they locked up some people in the room. Like there was no sunlight to recognize time, there was no watch, no tick-tick watch, so nothing. The food was always there and everything was there, and it was a dark room. And they wanted to know how long a human mind can remember time.
Okay.
And it turns out to be just 100 hours.
100 hours. After that, all sense of time is lost.
Our biological clock works maybe max.
Maybe max up to 100 hours, we have an estimate.
Yeah.
You know what, if we can't keep track of 100 hours, it just boggles my mind as to how we're able to understand things that happened 100 years back, 200 years back, 1,000 years back, millions and billions of years back. It's something that's truly astounding. To me, at least, I would think that, you know, it's not a figure of time that we can comprehend.
Yeah.
We can think about 1 year, 1 month, but a million years?
It's not a number.
We can't. We can say a million years, but
yeah.
we do not comprehend
yeah.
the gravity.
We
can't feel a million years.
Yeah.
And now especially people are talking about, you know, traveling to other planets. You know, we had this chat earlier
yeah.
about Stephen Hawking saying that,
yeah.
you know, we have only 100 years left on the planet.
Yeah.
We need to find another planet. This
yeah.
planet is doomed. We need to find another source of
yeah.
Another planet to settle upon. So where are we on that front as of now?
Right now, first we want to work on Mars and Moon. Those are the primary goals.
But terraforming Mars, you know, it's a huge thing, man.
Yeah, it's a huge thing, but it's a race right now, as Elon Musk says.
Elon Musk.
Yeah, he has just started the SpaceX going on with it, and he has to work on the... funding and other things. Mars and Moon are the two primary goals right now because they are nearer, and we are able to send certain objects there. It's in our reach, so but it's not an easy task.
Because
certainly, I would assume.
Lot of challenges are there. That's what makes more interesting, because more people are getting jobs,
mm-hmm.
and the applications coming out to answer those questions are amazing on Earth. As I told you, the solar paint itself is a great thing, because especially in India, we have a lot of energy crisis. And if that thing starts here, and it's going to be a revolutionary in the field of energy. It's a very exciting time, and we are able to print food. this is the time you can literally 3D print a pizza or a pancake or whatever you want. But we didn't think about
can
this.
Can we 3D print notes?
That's a big question. Maybe we can 2D print actually on a paper. So, yeah,
but legitimately speaking, that's how.
Hey, I'm just asking.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's get to your personal life. You know, Madhu, I'm very interested because here is a mind that is sitting in Bangalore, is thinking about the entire galaxy, the universe. Your mind is everywhere. How does your family cope with it, man?
It's not an easy task because sometimes they are very supportive. I have to say that because if they are not supportive, I couldn't do anything. Most of my frustration will be, you know, spent. Yeah, because and they are very supportive and they literally, you know, calm me down and, you know, if some things happen, because especially when things does not work out. For example, if somebody bashes your idea, it's not a pleasant feeling to have, and we debate about it, we argument, so many things goes on, and also sometimes you won't get observation time on telescopes. Those are very disturbing times.
You know what I think what helps is perhaps your wife, your brother, all of them are from scientific backgrounds.
Yeah.
So perhaps they understand a little bit of the craziness.
Yeah, they understand whatever. I'm happy that I'm able to explain what I'm doing. So
and they even bother to listen.
They bother to listen. That's a main key thing. Yeah, yeah, they're very supportive, and especially my dad has been, you know, truly supportive in many aspects. So he has not bothered me on anything. He has taken care of everything. So in that aspect, yeah, everything is in balance.
So what do you say to the young minds? You know, many people. At least in the time that I was growing up, we had become an engineer or become a doctor. Not many options. But now you can become an astrophysicist, you can become a biotechnologist, you can become so many things in the field of space, you know. Yeah. So what would you tell those young minds that look up at the sky, that are filled with awe, but, you know, they don't have the means or perhaps the inspiration to go ahead? What would you say to them?
Actually, passion is the key in this field. And it's not an easy task to just jump into the field because it sounds easier. Because the work we perform is at a very different level altogether. So what I suggest is you have a strong foundation. Like you get into a proper college, go through actual books, spend hours in library. That's old school. Yeah, old school style. There's no substitute for hard work. So once you start that, you know, everything should come up in place.
So for anybody who looks at a Carl Sagan documentary or a Neil deGrasse Tyson debate, and they think, wow, you know, this is very interesting. Let's get into astrophysics. Yeah. It's not that easy.
It's not so easy.
You have a lot of mathematics, a lot of equations, a lot of understanding.
See,
and patience, I believe, a lot.
Three things, yeah. Physics, math, and patience.
My God. So all of them are very, very serious things, by the way. You cannot neglect any one of that aspect of it.
Some people say, I want to do astronomy and I'm not interested. I have students because I teach. So they say, I'm interested in astronomy. I don't like mathematics. It's like you want to drive a car without a fuel. Mathematics is the background of everything. You need to learn math.
Yeah, math. I think you need to know the language of mathematics.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you cannot get into any sciences for that matter.
You can't do any sciences. So mathematics is a very key thing. So math, physics, you have to learn how to visualize things in physics. That's a very famous quote from a lot of people. You have to be a visionary to, you know, understand physics. So, and also do the math. Not everybody can do the math.
Yeah.
So that's where most of the people give up.
You know, I would rather say everybody can do it, but not everybody does it.
Exactly.
It's something that if you understand it, you understand it. Otherwise, not. You know, it's very interesting having spoken to you for so long, Madhu. And you know, I just think that perhaps in the future, many, many more minds like you, and you yourself, I would like to see you, you know, in the league of the Carl Sagans, of the Neil deGrasse Tysons, and the Bill Nyes, you know, the people who have, you know, created history. You know, you have a very persuasive argument that you make when it comes to science. You are a knowledgeable man, but, you know, I hope that many, many more people get what you're doing.
Actually, one main thing which, you know, makes me more passionate about this field is when I was a kid, I used to always look at this point, like when everything gets exhausted in the natural resources, man is a scavenging animal. That's what once everything gets lost, he moves in search of food. So eventually things, I don't know, is it enough for everybody? I don't know. So it's his attitude to go in search. So I like to, you know, be a part of that team.
Well, I hope your search never ends, Madhu, and I hope that you reach more and more heights, no pun intended. Reach for the stars. Yeah. Pleasure talking to you, Madhu. Godspeed. Thank you so much.